Hey, everybody, what's up? I'm Zach here with my co-host, Aaron.
What's up?
You're listening to A2Z Podcast, episode 72.
Today's guests are Heather Rushing and Daniel Stormont, two people who sold everything they own to hike the Appalachian Trail.
It's like they're trying to be too meta.
We're going to make them an offer they can't refuse.
Much better. Yeah.
Can I buy you a drink?
Well, he did pick out somebody we know.
Well, you sidestepped the question. That technology does not exist.
If this is your first time listening, thanks for checking us out. A2Z is a Southeast Texas local podcast. We do episodes out weekly on all major podcast platforms. But you can also follow us on Facebook and Instagram, where we post updates, clips, and extra content.
Also, don't forget about our Facebook groups. We have A2Z Podcast Group and A2Z Movie Night, the groupening, where you can talk with other listeners about episodes and share funny memes.
Yeah, that's a good part. It's a good party. Well, today we're talking to Heather and Daniel.
Yeah, it was kind of one of those last-minute things to go on. They were just about to leave for the trailhead, and I think they talked to us, and we talked to them. They're like, hey, before you guys go, let's get the before story, and then maybe when they get back, we can get the after story, you know?
Yeah.
So a lot of it is about just putting their life on hold,
right?
You know, selling all their stuff, figuring out where their dogs are going to stay, you know, that type of thing. And then also the process of researching how you actually do the dang thing.
Yeah.
What it's like out there, the preparations, the gear.
Also go into a little bit of history of how it started.
Yeah, yeah.
We kind of just dive into all things Appalachian Trail and hiking. So.
And we drink a few beers.
And that as well. That's a given. Well, if you like this episode, leave us some feedback. Any of reviews or anything on any of our social media pages, send us an email, feedback@azpodcast.com. But without further to do, enjoy this episode.
Is that how it goes? Further to do? I think it's further ado.
Further ado?
I think so.
Enjoy this episode with Heather and Daniel.
I'm going to some place where I've never been before. I'm going where the water tastes like wine. I'm going where the water tastes like wine.
Ah.
We can jump in the water.
Yeah, we had internet in Afghanistan.
Muslim countries have blocked internet.
Okay. It was satellite-fed internet, but it was pretty governed. But we used Tumblr for porn. I knew about Tumblr, but I didn't know it was... I thought it was just a GIF porn website.
That's pretty much what it is now.
I guess, kind of. I don't know.
Except, you know...
I never had to have a Tumblr.
Examples of porn vary, right?
Just to kick this whole thing off and get on topic, we brought y'all on... We brought y'all on to talk about this trip that y'all are about to make. If y'all want to expand upon that a little bit, like what are y'all doing?
Well, we are about to hike the Appalachian Trail.
Yeah.
We are about to through hike the Appalachian Trail from Springer Mountain, Georgia to Mount Katahdin, Maine.
How long is the trail? Like,
2,200 miles.
Roughly.
Jeez.
Across 14 states. Takes the average hiker about 6 months to do it.
And it's definitely not a straight line.
No.
You mean it's not just like a straight path that with like markers and like a nice like rock lined gravel areas? And
there are a few of those sections.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, trail's marked.
It crosses across a couple of highways. So there's certain sections that go across like highway bridges, like alongside on like a bike path.
Yeah.
And there's an entire section in New Jersey they call the boardwalk that is just a, like literally a wooden 2x4 sidewalk built up on like a dock system going across it because it's all marshland.
So it's kind of like an amalgamation of all these different trails because it goes through all these states and all this stuff. Everybody kind of does it differently in their own little space.
Well, I mean, it crosses through several like state park systems.
Yeah.
So the Appalachian Trail Conservancy is pretty much in charge of like taking care of trail maintenance and things like that. So it differs from terrain. There's a part we're going to cross that they call the Whites, which is like basically a rock scramble for a long time. There's a place up north that is referred to as the 100-mile wilderness, which is the most far removed like part of the trail from other towns or, you know, crossings for us to get supplies and stuff like that. It is a carved trail. Like there are markers along the way, like thousands of, how many people are already on the trail this year? We looked the
last
day.
I saw was, it was like 1,092 have already started.
Have already started.
Okay.
This year.
Yeah. And we start in almost a week.
Yeah. A week.
Like 8 days. from today?
Yeah, 8 days from today.
8 days from today.
So when you get there, when you get to the trailhead, it would probably not be uncommon for you to see other people doing the same thing at the same time.
Oh. Yeah, no, it's definitely going to happen. And, you know, there's everyone hikes their own pace. Everyone does their own trail. Some days we'll wake up and do 10 miles, 20 miles, 5 miles. Like, it just doesn't, we don't know what we're going to do. So there's pretty much like kind of the rule of thumb that I've read is about 5 days ahead of you and 5 days behind you, people who start with that 10-day spectrum will become your group.
Mm. Okay.
Like, we'll be in a group of like probably about 20 or 30 people who we just keep
because you'll be passing or they'll be passing you.
Or we'll be stopping at the same shelter
to
sleep for the night. And we'll end up seeing the same people constantly. So we'll end up forming a group.
So hopefully you get lucky.
Yeah, hopefully they're good people. Hopefully we're not.
Well, and like from, you know, all the big three trails in the United States are the Pacific Crest Trail, the Continental Divide Trail, and the Appalachian Trail. And this is sort of the one that, from like what I've come to understand, if you're out there to be like alone in nature and not see anybody or kind of be a little far removed, the Appalachian Trail is not the trail for you. There's so many people that go out, whether it be day hikers or section hikers or people attempting a through hike, that it's kind of impossible to really spend an elongated period of time alone.
But this trail's no joke, though. I mean, just because there's a lot of people on it doesn't mean it's super easy, I'd imagine. It's a really long way. It has very tough terrain. And also, it's like a really diverse terrain. I could imagine it'd be
tough. I mean, you're going from Georgia to Maine.
Yeah, no, and it's, exactly.
I wish I remembered the number. But it's the amount of elevation climbs we have to do would be like climbing Everest like 12 times or something like that.
Yeah, just up and down. And
up and down. Like
consistently.
It starts off with just to get to the trail itself, there's the approach trail, which is 8.8 miles.
Wait, there's approach trail to the Appalachian Trail?
Yes, it is. Before we ever get to the trail, we will hike 8.8 miles.
I guess that's to like weed out the people who decide to change their mind. I don't know.
Well, the trail goes from the peak of Mount Springer, Georgia, to the peak of Mount Katahdin.
So go down and then back up.
So you have to get you to can't the start top at a peak. Of Springer
you have
Mountain,
to hike
Georgia.
Almost 9 miles just to get to the beginning of the trail, and it's straight up a mountainside. But that's going to be one of our biggest elevation climbs. The biggest elevation climb I think we do will actually be Mount Katahdin at the end, which is going from 600-foot elevation to 4,000 in under six miles.
That's like in the Adirondacks, isn't it? Isn't that part of that?
I'm not sure about that. It's in northern Maine. It's Baxter State Park, Maine.
And that's the end of it is in Maine?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. That's such a long way. Like, if you just look on a map and just draw a straight line from Georgia to Maine, you're like, Jesus, that is so crazy.
Yeah, it's huge.
And then to think you're just like going, beep, you're just like beelining it everywhere, going up and down and across.
Do you have to bring like hiking, like not hiking gear, obviously, but you have to bring like like climbing gear?
No,
it's like you're able to get there.
When they built this park, they built this trail. It was a long process where they're trying to build it and everything. And there's a deep, like crazy political history of like how this came to be a trail where they had to build it and design it and everything like that.
Wait, and so this is all one trail?
This is one trail.
Like officially.
One trail. And actually the first person to through hike it was an Army veteran who he decided he was going to through hike it. And while he was through hiking, there was a conference where they were like, a through hike will never be possible.
Mm.
But they didn't know he was attempting to through hike it.
Right. And they didn't know he was a badass.
He through hiked the whole thing. And this was in like 1940 something. Yeah. He through hiked the whole thing and came out on the other end. And no one believed he did it. He had to like verify points that he was at certain times. And it took him a while just to verify that he did in fact pull it off.
Speaking of like history of through hikers, so my biggest like when I first started researching the trail, when we first decided that I was also going to go, because Daniel had already planned on through hiking this before I did. We joined several Appalachian Trail groups on Facebook. Mm-hmm. I think Daniel, you're in a couple of veterans only groups.
Two of them.
I'm in a women's only group on Facebook, and I kept seeing the like. So it's customary on the trail that you're given hiker names. while you're out there.
Boondog.
Which are sort of nicknames that people sort of gift upon you or you can kind of give yourself. And so everyone talked about this woman named Granny Gatewood or Grandma Gatewood. So I got really curious about that because every time somebody, like, especially in my women's group, when, like, people would have a moment of, like, well, I don't know if I can do this, or I'm worried about my gear, I'm worried about my pack, I'm worried about my body, like, everybody always, like, refers back to Grandma Gatewood. Mm. So I was like, well, I have to figure out who this is now. So I started researching, and this was the first woman to ever thru-hike the trail. She was in her 60s when she did it.
Wow.
And she completed it in, what, the 50s or the 60s? Something like that. It was 50s or the 60s. She was the first woman to ever thru-hike the trail. And she did it. She basically, like, revolutionized ultralight hiking because she sort of hiked the trail out of necessity. Like, she had some home problems and domestic violence problems that sort of pushed her into the woods, and she did it in a pair of keds. She
flat sole keg.
First, like, woman to ever through hike the Appalachian Trail was in her 60s.
And she's probably the only woman to do it in keds.
Did it on a pair of keds.
I don't know about that.
Perhaps. I'm not sure.
They probably would have done it out of honor by now.
So that brings me to this question is, like, so obviously you guys have been talking about this trip for quite a while. All of your friends know. I mean, we knew about it. Everyone knows about it. You're selling your stuff. How much shit have you got from people talking about you can't do this because you're a woman? Like, whenever you guys talk about this, everybody, how many times do people be like, well, I can see Daniel doing it.
Well, Daniel backs his chair up. No. Oh, yeah. God. So
granted, Daniel's ex-military, okay?
No, yeah. I know Daniel, that. I know that point.
Daniel's ex-military. Yeah. Man, so when I first... We decided that I was also going to hike the trail months before I ever told anybody. Like, we kind of kept it under wraps for a while. So before I told my family, friends...
Whose idea was it at first?
Daniel.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I'd been planning to hike the trail... I've wanted to hike the trail since I was in high school.
Right. So,
like,
way longer.
I've known about it. Yeah. I've done, like, pussyfooting research around just looking at it. And it wasn't until, like, last February, I was like, I bought my pack. I'm doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that was a year ago. I've been planning it.
So we kind of really, I mean, I knew who you were, but we really met in, like, July.
July.
And then, so the second, you know, we started seeing each other, I'd heard of the Appalachian Trail.
Yeah. Mm.
I really started doing a lot of research on it. Once I told everybody that I was also going, I had lots of moments of, like, I swear to God, I'm gonna explode. Like, if one more person, so it's really interesting. I mean, yes, like, Daniel's ex-military has a lot of experience. Obviously, everybody knows that he is capable of this kind of stuff. But yeah, there was a lot of negativity about, well, have you ever been in the woods? Have you gone camping? Do you know what you're getting yourself into? Which was incredibly frustrating because what that told me was, like, these people that were asking these questions of me, like, and it's different. Like, there have been some people that have genuinely expressed concern and asked questions, and that's one thing. But I've had a lot of the same people over and over again. Like, you don't know what you're getting yourself into.
Ugh.
I'm like, really? Did you hike the Appalachian Trail?
Yeah.
You didn't? Cool. And I guess what that sort of tells me is, like, these people are, they think I'm an idiot. You know, that tells me that, like, they have no faith in my ability to research or my ability to understand what it is I'm doing. Like, yes, I have painstakingly, like, researched this trip for a really long time. Like, we have spent hundreds of dollars in gear. Like, we are selling our worldly possessions and, like, leaving our entire life behind. But you're right. I have no idea. I have no clue what I'm doing.
I mean, even if you don't know what you're doing, who cares? Like, what? Don't, I mean, like.
Well, I mean, a lot of that has to do with just, like, not thinking that, I don't know, people are capable of accomplishing it, walking 2,200 miles. I mean, it's a huge feat.
It is a huge feat. And It's not the easiest trail in the world. I know that. I've done some research about it too before. But at the same time, like, you're from Southeast Texas. You're obviously a little country, right?
Thank you.
I mean, that's kind of the thing to it. I revert to that baseline where if I want to go walk a trail, I'd go walk a trail. I'm terribly out of shape, but I could do it.
Well, like,
because I'm from South Texas,
right? I mean, how many times have people asked you, like, oh, well, are y'all going to be living off the land out there?
Oh, yeah, it's...
Foraging berries.
That's been my number one question.
Fighting bobcats.
Are you bringing a gun?
Are you bringing a gun?
Are you bringing a gun? Number one question I get, and it's, we're crossing 14 state lines.
Right.
Every state has different gun laws, and after a certain point, we'll be crossing the Mason-Dixon line, and that's when the gun laws get crazy. You can't bring a gun. A, logistically and bureaucratically, a nightmare. A lot of red tape.
I could imagine. I never
also,
even thought about that.
Guns are heavy.
Yeah.
They weigh things.
Yeah.
I got my base weight down to 13 pounds so far.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
That's without food or water. 13
your base
pounds.
Weight is 13
and I'm carrying
pounds?
Our tent.
Is that including your boots? And
no, I don't count the wearables. Okay. Right, that's going to be my clothes, my sleeping bag, our tent, our stove, our pot, all of my gear.
That's incredible.
Everything is.
Most of it's going to be food and water, though. Shit.
Food and water is going to really boost it up. But still,
about
like,
10 pounds.
Your base weight is kind of what makes or breaks you. Like,
right.
If someone starts off with a 30 pound base weight and then you add 10 pounds of food and water, you're hiking with 40 pounds. Well, I'm hiking with 23.
And we've actually seen in one of our Appalachian Trail groups a fella, I think, what, third or fourth day, already off the trail.
He left on Friday. He started on Monday. He made it 5 days.
Yeah.
What did he
say? I believe it.
It chewed him up and spit him out. He quit.
Could not walk another step.
But he started with a 30-pound base weight.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Oh. But that's gotta be like that's really gotta be the rule, I'm sure that most people that started don't finish, right?
It's a
the
pretty
odds
low
are
success
six
rate.
To one.
Six to one. Okay, so that's true. So most people that started don't finish.
20% success rate.
It is a task.
Wait.
Actually,
damn it. 15%.
We don't do math too good.
That's right. Okay.
Math is hard.
So, yeah, I actually read earlier today that the success rate last year of thru hikers had dropped from 2017. The success rate of thru hikers in 2018 percentage-wise had dropped.
People are a lot softer now, okay?
I'm also going to say, you better not tell me it had nothing to do with global warming.
Well, that's one.
Because that is not true.
Well,
it is getting a lot
hotter. So one of the questions, the person who posted this, again, like, our whole life is trail. Like, we're in several different Facebook groups. It's all we do. It's all we read. Somebody asked, like, was this because last year had really unfavorable weather conditions?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts? And so folks that had thru-hiked last year and in years prior talked about it. Because in the, especially, like, the Smokies, it rains pretty much every day.
And when it's not, it's, like, misty. Yeah,
it's going to be the weather is never good. I was reading, someone posted the other day, they're like, what kind of weather apps are you guys using or anything to keep up with the weather? And someone was just like, some experienced thru hiker was like, it's the same every day. Partly cloudy with a chance of rain.
Every day.
You don't need anything else. Partly cloudy with a chance of rain.
Might rain, might be sunny.
Also, you're not going to have good signal in the mountains. I'm just letting you know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
I mean, does it get pretty far away from civilized areas? Or like?
Well, the 100-mile wilderness, as Heather mentioned earlier, is legitimately a 100-mile section. And it's not as wilderness as it used to be because now there's a lot of logging roads that run through it.
Oh, okay. Sure.
And if you really needed to, you could hitch a ride out of there.
Yeah.
But there's still a great like warning
sign.
Is
that the part that's like through the Pine Barrens or
that we
is
saw.
It through the Smokies? Or
It's
the,
up no, north. It's
up north. Okay.
So it's, if we're expecting, it's not going to be completely isolated. There's sections where we're walking along highways for miles and miles.
Oh, really?
Right. Okay.
That's the thing that kind of strikes, because anytime I've ever read about it or anything about it, is that it's because it's so long that like sections of it are like pieces of it are like more kept than others because this is where some people live near it and they'll just go and hike this one part of it.
Yeah.
And then, like, some sections go to, like, civilized areas and then everything like that. It's just such a strange thing.
It crosses through everything you could imagine wilderness to become on the East Coast. Like, where there's parts where we can't see the highway, but every now and then we'll hear a car cross. There are parts where we're hiking alongside highways. There's parts where we will not be anywhere near civilization for a while. I've actually heard a story of a group of hikers hiked up to a shelter. It was like a couple and they hiked up to a shelter and there was one person sitting there at the shelter and there was a big pile of gear laying on the shelter floor. And apparently the other two people who were there dumped all their gear out and ran off into the woods because they were from that area and they knew it was 3 miles due east. There was a gas station and they ran out there. They ran 3 miles through the woods, picked up a bunch of beer and brought it back to the shelter. And they all just drank and had fun. Okay. But they just emptied out their packs to load them up full of beer. So, you know, it's when you drive by like a tree line on the highway, like you just see the wall of trees.
Right.
You don't know what's going on 10 feet in or a mile in. And that's kind of what a lot of this trail is going to be is.
You're near civilization, but
we will be, and that's gonna be our.
You won't know where it is, really. I mean, maybe if you have a map, but
and we have a trail guide, and that's gonna be how we get food. Mostly, we'll be purifying our water, and for food, we'll just find a road nearby hitchhike into town.
Yeah.
So your trail guide, is it analog? Is it like a big laminated map, or is it digital?
It is a loose leaf book, so there's no binding, so we can burn the pages as we go through them.
Oh,
and
it's really interesting. Weight. Yeah, everybody, this is like their thing. It's there was a thru hiker whose trail name was AWOL, and he puts together and updates this Appalachian Trail like thru hikers guide every year, and it's basically like the Bible for thru hikers.
Yeah,
for that year. So you know, there's all kinds of information about towns you can stop in, hostels that are open, shuttle services.
Well, you said the hitchhiking thing is the places around that, the people are used to picking up hitchhikers because they live there.
They see it all the time.
It's a big part of their economy and their culture. Like if we stop, us living in the Golden Triangle area, there's so many plant workers here. If you stop at most gas stations in this area, they have like they have mills, like meal substitute stuff for plant workers.
Right.
They kind of tailor to them a little bit. Same way there. They're expecting us through hikers.
Yeah, the gas stations are going to sell propane tanks.
The gas stations are isopropylene, like little canisters for jet boils and MSR stoves. They'll sell MREs and stuff like that. Like little tuna
dehydrated
packets.
Foods.
They'll have exactly—
lots and lots of granola.
They know exactly what the hikers want. They know they're close to the trail. They're going to accommodate us to get our business because it's a part of their economy and their culture. And— I actually bought a bandana from the Appalachian Trail Conservatory thing that says on one side it says hiker to town, on the other side it says hiker to trail. So I can hang it from my pack.
Easy hitchhiking.
And just walk there
and walk
and then
to town.
Wait for
and if
to
someone
stop.
Sees me, they know I'm heading to town. They know to pick me up. Like it's, and vice versa. But it's a big part of their culture. They're used to us. Like
one of the things that I find so interesting is, you know, we've been able to watch a lot of YouTube, homemade documentaries, YouTube videos, follow people on Instagram, on Facebook that have already done this experience. So we've already tried to learn a lot about the culture of the trail, a lot about what we're getting ourselves into, things we're going to see, that I think is, you know, I couldn't imagine someone hiking this trail 10, 15, 20, even 30 years ago.
Yeah, with no information but what, I mean, maybe a book, maybe.
Maybe. That they would have to carry. And so, yeah, like, we've watched countless documentaries of people that have thru-hiked in previous years that are available on YouTube or, you know, on Amazon or what have you. So we've been able to figure out a lot about trail culture and being able to see from other thru-hikers' perspective, you know, their difficulties and their challenges. And we've been able to learn a whole lot. So it, in a way, it kind of feels like, I don't know, like we already know what we're getting ourselves into, I know that we're going to get out there and it's going to be—
once you're out there,
so it's much different when we are out there.
It's always different when you're in the water as opposed to like someone teaching you how to swim.
Exactly.
That's like the difference, yeah.
What kind of outcome are y'all looking for? I mean, I know what you would want to say is finish it, you know, but you know, that's just it.
I mean, man, just we want to crest Katahdin.
Yeah.
Honestly, like, yeah, it's finish it. Like, it's just a notch on the belt. Like at this point, like, just be able to say I did that. Like, it's there, it exists, it's free. It costs. I think last I checked, it cost $40,000 for a base pass to Everest.
Jeez.
It's very expensive. Yeah, that's
$40,000 just to attempt to climb it. That's not counting gear. That's not counting everything else. $40,000 just for a base pass.
You have to pay $40,000 to get a pass to go to the mountain.
It's very, very expensive.
Well, people die up there. Yeah. Well, I mean, they need to make sure you're serious.
This is free. This costs nothing. It costs us in gear. It costs us to buy food.
Yeah, food, gear. I think we pay $5 to get into Amicalola State Park.
No, that's waived for thru hikers.
Is it?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
It's completely free for thru-hikers. So this is a free thing that exists. The only reason you have not to do it is you don't have the time or, you know, the money. But it's your money is just you funding your food for 6 months,
that's
give or take.
Just surviving. You're not like paying dues or
something. You're not paying fees or it's completely free to anybody.
I mean, our goal is to crest Katahdin.
Yeah.
So to go back one step, you guys were just talking about like the YouTubers and the Instagrammers and all these guys that are doing it and documenting it, and that's a resource for y'all to look at. Do you have what is your plans to do the same? Like, do you have plans to try to document your journey and do the same exact thing that you're seeing now?
So Daniel, you just made a Facebook.
I did. I made a Facebook, and you just made us a group that combined the two of our Facebooks.
I did. So Daniel didn't have a social media prior to a couple of months ago. He was kind of off the grid. And I think his idea was to create a social media.
He's about to be back off the grid.
Hey. I think his idea was like, he was kind of off the grid. Social media really wasn't what your thing.
Yeah.
So he made a Facebook, and this whole idea was like, we want other people to be able to experience what we're experiencing.
Yeah.
So we made a Facebook page for, you know, your coworkers, your friends and family, my friends and family, to just follow us in one succinct little place. So we did make a Facebook group. And yeah, I mean, cell towers have definitely come a long way. So even though we're going to be out in the backcountry, you know, there's going to be a lot of parts where we probably won't have reception. We
in
won't
the valleys,
be able
you won't have
to
anything.
Get data. Yeah. But there's a lot of the trail that we will have phone reception. So, yeah, I mean, we'll be posting.
If it's like just an update whenever you can update.
Exactly. You know? When we go into town, I mean, we'll be posting as many videos, photos, documenting our trip as much as is humanly possible, just for the sake of doing so.
There's going to be a lot of stuff we're going to want to share with everyone. There's going to be, you know, it's a big deal. It's going to be a lot of fun. There's going to be a lot of stuff we weren't going to share. And as far as like making our own documentary or really like making a social media
Something serious out of it,
we might, honestly,
we'll see what happens.
We're going to get out there and just see what it feels like. Like, it's not our goal. Our goal is just to walk the thing.
Hey, Heather, will you give me one too?
Me too. You don't mind? But no, our goal is just to get out there and hike the whole thing.
Yeah.
Whatever it's, you know, if we feel like we have time or the energy or even the passion or drive to be like, to care about social media, then maybe we'll do a little bit more, but it's just kind of whatever comes up. Like,
God, y'all gotta be so excited right now.
It doesn't feel real yet.
I would really hope that you document a lot, because that's one thing that I really like watching on YouTube and stuff like that is Campcraft. I don't know why. It's just really relaxing to me. And I always have. Like, when I go to sleep.
That's what you watch when you go to sleep?
Sometimes
it's people camping.
So sometimes it's woodworking, right? Sometimes it's woodworking. Sometimes it's just a video and audio of an oscillating fan. And sometimes
some ASMR to put you
sometimes
to sleep,
it's camp crafting. There's actually
poor folks.
Primitive
poor
technology
folks
stuff.
Techniques.
But, you know, there's a lot of cool stuff like that that people like me and everywhere else would do. You just do like a little short video of like, hey, this is how we start our fire on a day-to-day. Maybe you have like a special little technique and you do that.
It'd be a lighter and isobutane stove. We're not roughing it that much. Lighters are lightweight.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's true. Yeah.
I mean, that's been, it's actually really funny. That's been probably one of the biggest things I've been like deflecting a lot of.
People thinking that you're about to go.
Because we're
from
Southeast Texas. We've got a lot of country here.
Right.
A lot of people know how to live in the woods here. Believe it or not, or at least they think they do. And
at least they think they do.
And they have advice. They have advice. So
they all
have. You should carry this, or you should do this. And it's like that weighs something. Like,
right, you know, absolutely. Man, if you're not going to bring a pistol, you need to bring a shotgun.
Exactly. And you're like, man, we're literally hiking 2,200 miles.
But what about the
bears,
man?
Is going to be exactly. What about the bear?
There's no dangerous animals there, though.
What about? Well, I mean,
do y'all have to have bear boxes?
For certain sections of the trail, we will.
So we won't be camping there.
Our trail guide will let us know.
Because we ain't got a bear
between this section and this section, you're required to have a bear box. And we'll be like, okay, well, we'll plan ahead to make sure we can stop before there.
Right, right.
Get some sleep and hike straight through that section.
Yeah.
Our first one comes up at Neal's Gap, and it's an 8-mile section. We're going to have to blow right through. because which actually has one of the oldest shelters in the on the AT.
Really?
It's this little stone cabin out there.
Do y'all just not want to buy a bear box, or are y'all
we
scared
just
of bears?
Don't have
they
the
don't
room
carry
for
it.
A bear canister.
Yeah, they're like they're big. Right?
I mean, they're really bulky. They're really large. I mean, our packs only have so much liter capacity to them.
What it's kind of packs just, y'all are on, like 60 liters or?
We have the some big boys. 60, right?
I'm carrying an Osprey. Both of us are carrying Osprey brand. I'm basically carrying the women's version of his pack, okay. which is the Asia 58 liter.
Okay.
And the Exos.
And he has the Exos.
58 liter. But those liters change based on your size. We're both wearing small packs. So mine's
shorties.
Mine's really like 55 liters.
Mine's probably around the same. So we only have so much space. I mean, you have to think about all the stuff you have to cram in there. And a beer canister, I mean, some people are bringing them. Some people are bringing Ursacs, which are like these, like Kevlar, bear-proof,
smell-proof,
animal-proof. Well, they're not odor-proof. You have to put an odor-proof bag inside of an Ursac. They're very expensive. We decided—
Can't you just pull it up in a tree?
We decided to go old school. We have a dry sack that we are hanging our bear bag.
I thought the people who run the parks are trying to get people to stop doing that. Or maybe it's because they don't do it properly.
I think it depends on place to place. One of the things that you know we've been seeing a lot of in our—
They have actual poles out there for that, too.
On some of the shelters, they do. And our guidebook actually tells you if they have, if like the upcoming shelter, if it has a privy, a bathroom, or an outhouse or whatever. Or
so
if it has—
They have shelters, like actual.
Oh yeah,
like,
and you're. Yeah. We actually have to camp at the shelters, and the shelter
the
could
Smoky
be anything
Mountains.
From a like
in the Smoky Mountains.
They could most places. Mm-hmm. It could be a cabin. It could be just, but most of the shelters are going to be like a wooden box that's
okay,
just
yeah,
a
yeah.
roof.
Yeah.
It's
and
like
three
a barn.
Walls and
yeah,
open
yeah.
On
a
one
barn
side.
With a wall cut off.
There is
yeah.
one
like
that
a
is
Morgan
actually
building
a barn
or something. Yeah, like a little Morgan.
And some of them, like our guide will tell you if it has a privy, like a bathroom, it has a water source. How far away that water source is and what it is. And it'll tell you if it has bear boxes there. Like some shelters actually come with bear boxes, like where they have this big stainless or, you know.
They look kind of like a mailbox, don't they?
Some of them.
Yeah,
some
of them
are farther away from the camp.
Some of them have, and there's just a big, like someone went out there and welded a metal box of 1/4 inch thick sheet metal and has a padlock on it. All the hikers can throw their food in there.
Right.
Just keep it out of bear's reach.
So since all these shelters are dotted along the trail, are you guys not bringing like a ultralight tent or anything like that?
Yeah, we are.
Okay.
Oh yeah, we are.
We have, you want to tell them?
You have to be prepared for all elements. Okay. So both of us have, sleeping bags. We both have, I mean, we're carrying a 2-person tent. So the tent that we have is a Big Agnes, UL Scout.
Agnes?
To Big Agnes. Big Agnes.
She's a sturdy old broad.
Yeah, she's a sturdy old broad, which is a really well-rated brand along the trail. One of the things that we talked about is a little different is we're only carrying a single wall tent.
Which is kind of a bad idea.
Why?
Well, we don't know that.
Is it for the cold?
I think it's a great idea.
I think it's a great idea. Yeah. But we're carrying a single wall tent. The problem with a single wall tent is most tents have like the tent body and the rainfly, which allows condensation and heat to rise and leave.
Yeah.
Single wall tents are notorious for having a lot of condensation inside.
Right.
So Daniel just don't breathe very heavy.
You're the snorer.
Yeah, all right.
Leave that zipper open a little bit.
Yeah.
You know?
So that's what you're going to have to do. And I think, but this one's supposed to be designed to combat that.
It's extraordinarily lightweight.
So single wall's lighter.
Then. So it's like,
it doesn't
what
have
is it, like
any,
1.5 pounds?
About that. Yeah. It doesn't have any tent poles at all.
We use our trekking
poles. Poles as tent poles.
That's ridiculous.
So that makes it even better because now the weight we're carrying for our tent and the weight we're carrying for our trekking poles is now kind of combined. Like if one thing can do two things.
We have tried to vary.
That's the biggest
better.
Thing about backpacking, right?
Which is why our base weights are so
that's
late.
Why
we're doing utilitarian.
Both of our sleeping bags are water resistant down. Mm. Like down has the best But the only problem with best like insulation for the lightest weight.
You can mess it up though.
But the only problem with down is if it gets wet, it's useless. If cotton gets wet, it's fine.
Yeah.
Right.
But cotton is not antimicrobial.
Uh-uh.
It does not wick moisture. It absorbs
cotton,
it.
Cotton's just bad all
cotton
around.
Is cotton is death. Kills. Cotton kills. Yeah. Like you can't wait. So nothing we have is
cotton.
Is that
what cotton. They say? On, is it with tear?
Yeah.
That's the trail.
It doesn't
phrase.
Dry.
Kills.
I've so heard none of y'all's clothes. Say it too.
None of your clothes. No.
Heather has a wool tank top, a wool dress. We both have wool underwear, wool socks.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's wool or down for us.
Yeah.
And
or with synthetic
blends.
Synthetic.
Or
synthetic.
Yeah. Yeah. Moisture wicking.
But no cotton.
Well, you got those pants with the zip off knees.
I do have
he
those. I wore them to the bar just the other day.
He's going to look like somebody's dad out there.
No, you're just going to look like 1998 called.
And they only said, look bad whenever you have them as pants. Whenever they have shorts, they
I mean,
look,
you know,
okay.
One of the things we have to think about is we're only carrying one. We're hiking in the same clothes every.
Yeah, but different underwear though, right?
Day. We have two pair of underwear.
Man, y'all getting dirty.
We have three pair of socks. We have a set of camp clothes.
Y'all shower every now and then.
I'm yeah, sure. Every like
week. Once a week.
So
week,
if yeah. I could give a little like ex officio makes.
Hell yeah.
Oh, shout out to ex officio.
Shout out to ex officio.
Was that like wipes?
They're underwear.
Ex officio makes.
Underwear.
They make clothing.
They're amazing.
For people with like office-y positions.
Ever
who want to look like they're like office-y high up people to be out in the field.
Mm.
So, like, if you're a foreman of a construction company, wear ex officio. Like, you can wear a button-down shirt and slacks and underwear and look professional.
But they're stained.
But you're not sweating.
It's designed for being out in
everything.
The field.
Oh, okay.
The underwear I have they're a wool blend, synthetic blend, and they're designed to be worn until they cannot be worn anymore, turned inside out and worn again.
I love that that whole part of our conversation has boiled down to our undergarment.
Yeah, it's important. That's important. That, yeah, that's cool.
Cotton kills.
Well, both of us are wearing ex officios. We're in love with them. I will never own anything ever again.
Yeah, shout out to ex officios.
It's $10 ever. A pair. It's like $12, $20 a pair.
Mine were like $20.
That's comparative.
I have one pair of ex officio underwear and I paid $30 for them.
Yeah,
they're worth it.
Wow. I bought them 3 or 4 years ago and they are amazing.
So I don't wear underwear at all and I would just die. If I try to do this, I'll just fucking
a lot
die.
Of people freeball out there.
Freeballing is actually better than underwear.
Really?
Not for me.
It's lighter.
Okay.
It's lighter.
It's lighter.
And also,
but...
like, well, if you're wearing the right pants, like,
yeah.
You don't have, and like, you're not a heavy set guy.
Not
you don't have to
me.
Worry about like wicking or like chafing.
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah, dude. Have you seen my thighs, bro? They rub. My thighs rub, dog.
But okay, so like, with all that, do you have to, okay, so like, I got a hiking backpack for Christmas. Because I've been planning on going and doing that, but
ooh,
I just never did. I got a Kelty Red Wing.
Oh,
Red Wing's not bad.
It's a little cheapy. It's a little $100 50 liter, but it's all I need because I'm not going out for 6 months. I'm gonna do like 3 or 4 day trips.
Yeah.
But do you have to like bring like? Do you have to like? What is that? The powder? You gotta bring the Gold Bond powder. You're walking
I'm just
so much.
Bringing baby powder because it doubles. If we have chafing issues, there it goes. We can stick it in our hair, dry up some oil.
That's true.
That's my lady powder.
Gold Bond is great. Powder. It's a great product.
I don't want to put Gold
Bond
in
so
my hair.
But it's so specific. It's so
specific.
Specific mm-hmm. to its use. That like
what is its specific use?
Gold Bond, the one that's the yellow thing, is for your crotch and your butt.
Is that
basically.
Specifically for your crotch?
Yeah,
and
the
butt?
One that's
really?
In the blue one. The one that's in blue one is specifically for your feet.
You don't want to mix those up. I've done it before. It's a bad time.
You do not want to mix them
what?
Up.
What? Why? You put the ball stuff on your feet?
They have different levels of like mentholatum and stuff.
You put get the blue menthol.
You want to take a break? Let's take a break.
Yeah, I'm down.
Let's take a break. And then when we come back, we'll kind of talk about what you guys have had to do to get ready for it. We'll talk about like selling all your possessions and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Hey, this is your favorite host, Aaron.
Yeah.
And you're listening to A to Z Podcast. A to Z Podcast is funded in part by our patrons at Patreon. If you would like to support us, head on over to patreon.com/A to Z BMT.
All right, guys, it is the mid-episode break portion where we decide to tell you guys some things that are going on in your area. And on May 31st at Jefferson Theater, that's downtown, we have Raiders of the Lost Ark, probably everyone's favorite.
It's
Indiana
mine.
Jones.
Yeah.
Anyway, doors open at 6. The movie starts at 7:30. It's $5. Look, it's cheaper than Cinemark.
I think they usually
town.
Have a band that plays before.
Do they really?
They have been doing that, yeah.
Anyway, you know, it's a good time. It's family fun. Get down there. Get down to downtown.
And then the next day, Saturday, at the same location, June 1st, 12th, at Jefferson Theater, 12th Annual Jazz and Blues Fest. It's going to be headlined by Mr. Mike Zito. I think he's doing some kind of Allman Brothers tribute. Then you got Paul Childers. You got my good buddy Ron Rocio and the Rocio Jazz Project. And then you also got this band called Flying Buffaloes. I did a little run with them with the band that I work for. And these guys are really cool. They do like some old school kind of classic rock Americana stuff. Doors are going to be at 5. It's a festival, so it's going to go all day. And it's $20 at the door.
I'm sure there'll be some food and drink there too. So.
Yeah, but you know, we also wanted to tag on the end of this to let y'all know about all the new shows coming out.
Yeah, we have a lot of creative and entertaining people working in the A to Z studios right now, and we're very blessed to bring you all this content. Well, we're not bringing it to you, obviously.
No.
It's them.
But they're doing it here in this place.
We're just trying to help out a little bit, but yeah. It's really cool. We have the Box of Content guys. It's a whole bunch of dudes who pretty much their shtick is they have this box sitting on the desk right here, and they have all kinds of things just muddled up and put in there like a surprise.
Yeah.
They pull it out, they discuss. Some of it's topical, some of it's timeless. I don't know. You just have to listen and find out.
Yeah, and then also after that, I think on the same day as the 12th Annual Jazz and Blues Fest, you got Tyler Troutman's going to be dropping his podcast finally.
That's right. He is one of our alumni. He was one of maybe the first 10 or 15 that we ever did.
I think so.
He's a natural on the mic. You guys are going to love it. It's Tyler knows, with, you know, cross out, knows everything. It's going to be great. And what I'm really excited about with his podcast is he's getting some extremely interesting people on there. Like he showed me the list of his people, and it's all those people that make me feel like a lazy piece of shit.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, and then on top of that, we got, I think, Didgeridoo Dave's Eclectic Music Hour
that's
coming.
It's going to
be a little improv show. And then I don't even know if we can say the name on it, but...
No, we're not going to say the name, but we can tell you that if you're getting tired of, like, interview-style podcasts, that's the one you're going to love.
Yeah.
It's more like... What would you say it's more like?
I can't really say.
It feels like Comedy Bang Bang to me, kind of.
Well, I already said the name, so...
In a certain way, but...
Oh, well. You'll just have to figure it out. That's coming soon. We also got Pussy Control and Prozac.
Yeah, they just started, but it's gonna be fun. It's fun to have some female representation around here, huh?
I don't know. I'm just excited about everything that's going on in here, and I don't know exactly when all these things are coming out, but they are coming out, and you can expect us to be interviewing everybody involved to get the scoop on it. But you know what? We've talked enough, and we're gonna get back to Heather and Dave.
There we go. That's comfortable.
Yeah, get comfy. That's your mic.
You like all the tidying I did, Aaron? All the wires?
I do. I like it.
The wires
it. It
are hidden in the,
really good.
In the guest mics. And...
It looks really, really good. We have to compete now.
What?
There's somebody else that's open. They're, well, not opening. They've started a podcast studio in Beaumont.
I saw that.
So it's pretty cool. I think it's kind of cool, actually.
Yeah, I think
to be honest
great.
With you.
Well.
You know?
Whatever.
But...
Well, I mean, the thing that I see from it is that they have so many followers, but whenever I click on their followers, it's four mutual friends. So that means that there are hundreds of people that I have no idea about, that know nothing about us, that, you know?
Yeah, completely different.
We live in an echo chamber, is basically what he's saying.
Yeah.
I think that's a big problem in Beaumont as a whole.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Like, I've noticed, like, because I'm not from Beaumont.
Right, right.
So... One of the things I've noticed about Beaumont is there's a lot going on here, but to even know about it, you must know someone involved in it. Everything is kind of like
isolated,
spoken word here, like word of mouth. Like you have to know someone who knows somebody to know about what's going on.
It's like an interesting barrier of entry.
Well, I mean, I mean, like once
I wouldn't even call it. It's not even an intentional barrier. It's just how it is.
Well, one time when me and Heather first started seeing each other. I remember this specifically because I was just talking about the same thing with someone else. You walked up and handed Heather and Chris Presley an A to Z sticker.
Mm. Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay.
Oh, yeah. That was on my phone for a while.
Yeah, but you like...
They were cheap. They were cheap stickers, yeah.
You said, hey, to me, we know each other from the bar, but... You know, you totally bypassed me.
Ooh,
on
call
that
them out, Daniel.
Oh,
you gave them to
call
you gave
them
the
out.
Two people who you know about you in your podcast. It had no clue you had a podcast.
Yeah.
But I didn't give you one.
You didn't give him the one
and
person
who doesn't
know.
And I was like, Daniel, stop being so butthurt.
I wasn't butthurt.
No, that makes sense. Okay, no, granted, makes a lot of sense.
He only
yeah.
gave me a certain amount of them.
That's true.
But that
that's
was like, it was kind of to further to my point that like the problem, like yeah. one of the problems.
I think that's a pretty general problem though. I don't know if that's just.
But
problem.
I mean, had they given you a sticker about something you don't know, would you have been like talking them up? Because
that was
mine
really,
was on the back of my phone.
Yeah. That was
and
really
people
the reason.
Be like, oh, what is A to Z? And I'm like, oh.
So it's like, I'm going to give them to the people that I know.
These are some people. Yeah. Like, I know these people. I'm going to talk.
But the point's
you would,
still
you
valid.
Probably would have
no,
thrown
it's
it away.
A valid point.
The
I'm
point's
sorry.
Still quite
I mean,
valid.
We had a music festival like almost it was like a year or so ago. We had a music festival in downtown Beaumont.
Yeah, so which one?
I don't remember. Exactly. I didn't know it was happening until I was talking with someone who was one of the bands who was playing at Thirsty's.
Said that they were.
They were like, "Oh yeah, we're gonna be at that music festival tomorrow in downtown Beaumont." And I was like, "There's a music festival in downtown Beaumont?"
Yeah, that's kind
of well,
how it works,
you didn't
man.
Have social media,
no clue that,
so
that is a given there too.
Sat inside of your home.
Well,
expecting people to hand you stickers.
Well, I want stickers, and I would like to know.
I'll get you a sticker.
He'll get you a sticker.
I'm a cool person. I
They're not
be
waterproof,
involved.
Though, if you put them on
yeah,
your back.
Yeah, actually, I need to work on getting some waterproof ones. The ones I bought were, like, really cheap. I was just, like, kind of testing out this
and you printer. Set, you put it on your phone case. You set it in one, like, drink.
If you set it in one little puddle or, like, in a coaster a ring. Yeah, it's done. It's done.
Yeah, it's a bit, it's. I mean, that wasn't a very... Like, I get what you were doing. That's not like it wasn't a shot against you. It's just like, that is something that's like,
no, dude, no,
that is a Beaumont thing.
I appreciate
it. I
think it
is, yeah.
Beaumont's a very incestuous.
Well, because
it is.
If you don't have social media, it's also
I've said those exact same things whenever I started, because I've been doing sound in the area for like a decade now. And whenever I first started working with bands and working in Beaumont, I said the exact same thing because there were these cliques and I wasn't invited. And I always railed against that, but then I inadvertently did it. Too. So I guess maybe there's something in the water.
It's just human nature.
Maybe so.
Yeah. What are we going to talk about? What do you want
to... Well, we said before the break that we were going to come back and we were going to talk about the lead up to the trip. And we said we were going to talk about what it's like to A, quit your job.
Yeah.
B, sell all your shit.
Y'all got juicy quitting stories?
And then C, like buy all the stuff. So, yeah. So first of all, what is it like to first of all... decide you want to do this crazy thing, and then what's the next step? So you guys decide, we're going to hike the trail, we're going to do this. First step is probably quitting your job, right?
Yeah. I decided I was doing this last February. Like, that's when I drew a line. I was like, I'm doing it. Like, I'm leaving next year.
Because there's a season to do it, right?
There is.
There's a time to leave.
You have a time window of when you have to be at the end and the best possible weather, so... That's where we're starting is right the best time to start. But I decided I was quitting my job. But I didn't tell my job I was quitting in a year. I didn't let them know.
Like, I didn't let them know. I had well, the back of my mind.
There was a lot of angles I had to work with my job. I had a union job. I was working for Chevron. I wasn't a contractor. I was working for Chevron with a union job. So there were some angles I was looking at. Of how is it going to play this? Like,
now, how many times do people say, "Why in God's name would you quit a job working for a major company?" With
a lot,
union dues?
A lot. Like, I was the youngest person there, and not to brag or whatever, but I was making $100,000 a year.
Yeah,
weird
and I was
flex,
the youngest
but okay.
Yeah,
I'm just kidding.
I was the youngest person there, and people were like. You're leaving this, you're in a job. Like,
this is a career.
This is a career.
Oh, yeah,
and it's but I'm working 60 hours a week and I don't have all my money is mine. I don't have kids or child support or alimony or anything like that. Mm-hmm. Like, my money's my money. And I'm living like an old man supporting a family when I'm by myself and I don't have any time to do anything.
Mm.
So I can make more money. I can't make more time. That's pretty much my logic to diffuse them. But no, quitting was interesting. I gave them a month's notice that I was quitting my job instead of the standard 2 weeks.
That's a good thing. They should be happy for that.
Yeah. Ideally, though, I decided to just go ahead and quit instead of taking a leave of absence or a hiatus.
Like with the hopes of they'd hold on to your job.
Well, they would. They would have held on to it for me for... It takes them a long time to get people off the books because that... Like, I possibly could have, like, being prior military... And everything that comes along with that.
Yeah.
You know, I did 2 tours to Afghanistan, like not jumping at cars, doors shutting, but like I do have a little bit of PTSD. I could have worked that angle and been taking a mental stress leave for 6 months at full pay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I could have been paid the entire time we were doing this. But I don't know if I'm coming back. at all. So
right, right.
I don't want to like.
You want to leave them high and dry.
I don't want to leave them high and dry and then leave.
But it also it adds another level of commitment to what you're doing, I guess.
Yeah, it definitely does. Like, I didn't want to leave them high and dry and then like not come back to this area. And then it took them forever to replace me because they can't replace me until they take me off the books.
Right.
And there's a whole lot of stuff involved in that. And I didn't want to do that. So I ended up giving them a month's notice that I was quitting. So that way they could replace me a lot quicker. I can train the person who's replacing me, as well as I'm leaving on such good terms that I'll actually have priority to come back to any Chevron plant. Not
if
just
you
the
decided,
one
if you decided to do that,
if I decided to, in the future, if when I need a job like that, because frankly, I didn't really need the job I had. Like, it wasn't the money was good, but it wasn't a fulfilling job.
No,
so
I can I can attest to that.
If sure. I need when I need the job again, I will be able to walk in with priority if I ever need that job again. Like, but who knows? This hiking the Appalachian Trail is going at the top of my resume.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so elite. It's an elite thing.
Whatever doors this opens for me, I hope they're better than what I've had.
It's 20%.
It's an interesting thing to put at the top of your resume, for sure.
But at the end, if it doesn't open anything up, I can always go back. Yeah. Because I left on such good terms. And that was that's my plan of action for quitting my job.
What about you, Heather? What was yours like?
Did
you get to do a big fuck you? Come on. I need to hear.
You know,
I need a big fuck you.
I really wish I could have. My big fuck you actually was later. I mean, earlier rather. So I hit the reset button on my life last summer. So June, July, you know, I was bartending for a long time. I left bartending. I decided to get a big girl job. I went to work at the blood bank.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and it was the absolute worst job experience I think I've ever had in my entire lifetime.
Oh, no.
I learned a lot, and I really loved the industry, but the actual job was a horrible, horrible place.
What, a blood bank?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Maybe we can say that for another.
Well, I don't. Hey, I don't
a lot of vampires.
I don't work there. I can say whatever the heck I feel like. My big fuck you, I quit moment was, last summer, I kind of hit the reset button on my life. I quit my job on the spot, making myself ineligible for rehire because I did not give notice. Ooh. Quit my job with $97 in my bank account. I ended a relationship. I moved. I sort of like took inventory of my life last summer and said, I like none of this.
Yeah.
This is not who I am. This is not where I want to go. So I looked at everything I hated about my life or everything I didn't enjoy about my life, and I decided to change it. Yeah. So took the jump. I actually went back to bartending at a dive bar that I worked at prior to my big girl job, and they were absolutely happy to have me back.
What bar was that?
Do it.
What bar was that?
I worked at the Silver Fox in Bridge City.
Ooh.
So I actually went back to working there when I left my big girl job. So when I let them know that I was leaving.
We're going to miss you. All right. You got your job back whenever you come back.
Yeah.
You're doing what?
Yeah. That's no. Yeah. Precisely. Bingo, bingo, and bingo. This past Saturday was my last shift, but they threw a going away party for me on Friday night.
Shout out to the Silver Fox.
Shout out to the Silver Fox.
For being goddamn supportive.
I didn't even know that place existed. Honestly.
They were so supportive. I walked in Friday. We do karaoke on Fridays. I usually always work karaoke night. I walked in. There were posters all over the place. They had decorated the entire bar. They had planned a going away party for me.
That's so sweet.
People were pinning money.
Aw,
like,
that's so nice.
Like it was my birthday.
That's like really nice.
Yeah.
We had several toasts, and I only cried like 17 times. they had a going away card for me. My bar manager, who is very much like a maternal figure.
Yeah,
yeah.
All the Facebook posts, all of the, oh my God, we're going to miss her. Good luck. It was sad. It was like a bittersweet.
No, but that's the best kind of send off, I'd say.
Yeah.
For sure.
Absolutely. So I had a lot of support there. But because I had already pushed the reset button on my life. I think this is just a continuation.
It's just like a furthering into that reset.
Continuation.
It's like now, okay, so I know exactly what I don't like to do. Now let me find some stuff that I do like to do.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's the
start
first.
Over.
That was like the first part of it is quitting your job. That's step one. And then the second step is All your research, which we already talked about, you know, the gear and all that. And then it's like the acquisition of money to try to like get said gear and all that. So I,
well, you kind of have everything backwards.
Oh, you, so,
dude, quit your job is last.
That's the last.
Oh, I do. Person. Okay. Well,
yeah.
That works. You know,
I don't know. I mean, what, I mean, just to ask, like what, how much has it costed you to be, or cost you to be prepared for this? Like what's,
so,
what's it
let's say I'm going to go off just the average numbers here. The average hiker is going to pay up to about $4,000 in gear per hiker.
Okay.
That's about right.
You know, not
$4,000 in gear for like 20 pounds of stuff.
Yeah, these
stuff
are
expensive.
I mean, if money is not an object to you, if you're kind of like a Silver Star,
oh yeah,
hiker, if you're buying like the best gear possible, it can get very pricey.
So it can. So I think we probably definitely between two of us probably came less than $4,000.
Okay.
Total.
We could have done it a lot cheaper.
Mm. We could have done it a little bit cheaper here and there. There's spots where we could have went way more expensive and we didn't.
You could have bought used and
yeah. There's shout out to REI.
Hell yeah.
They're amazing. They're the best return policy in the world.
I wish we had one too. We've been back and forth to Houston.
We've been to every REI in Houston at least twice.
In the greater Houston area at least twice. Yeah.
So there's three of them there.
Juggling two jobs. I mean, juggling his job and my job and our schedule.
So when we had time to go. So the gear is, you know, you can expect to spend up to $4,000 in gear. And, you know, we talked about the person earlier who had like 30-pound base weight. Mm. There's like a bell curve when it comes to gear.
Yeah.
On like price wise, like where it's really light.
Yeah.
It's super expensive. And then it gets cheaper. And then it's more expensive again as it gets heavier because then it's more durable.
Okay. Yeah. Like, okay. So yeah. Like, I got that.
Your two man.
Like extreme weather stuff.
Like a one man tent that is like a three season tent that costs like, that weighs a pound or almost 2 pounds. Would be like $500.
Right.
And then they get cheaper. And then they, another one-man tent that weighs like 25 pounds.
Well, the good thing is they're counting price. You're counting ounces on the, and maybe even grams on the ultralight stuff. So the difference between like the really, really light stuff and the stuff that's more affordable and not as light is usually like half a pound.
I mean,
it really is.
We're kind of going ultralight, but to get back to the original question, you know, as far as how much this is costing us, the average thru-hiker spends about $6,000
for
their
through
hike. So about,
because it takes like six
months.
Well,
no, just
right?
Yeah, about okay. 6 months. So you're really budgeting about $1,000 a month per person.
Yeah.
You want to make sure that you have enough money
that's
for supplies.
Gear?
No.
So
that is
after.
Actually on the trail.
Yeah.
So that's that $1,000 a month is accounting for making sure that you have enough food, mm-hmm. making mm-hmm. sure that you're able to resupply, replacing your shoes, your trail runners or your boots. Only get X amount of miles on them, making sure a lot of, you know, we'll be staying in a couple of hostels here and there.
Maybe a hotel if we need a jacuzzi.
Maybe a hotel
tub.
Here and there. Yeah, if we take a zero day.
If you want to take a shower.
Get a bath bomb and a jacuzzi cup is going to
happen.
Get
a shower, yeah. So the average hiker budget's about $1,000 a month, so about
$6,000. And all the Epsom salt, right, too, right?
Yeah. So you really save a lot of money to spend a lot of money to pretend like you're homeless in the woods. Interesting. Well, we actually will be homeless.
Right. But you are homeless, though, right?
We will be homeless.
You're not going to be paying like a lease on a place in this same time,
no,
right?
No, we have gotten rid of both of our apartments.
Both of our apartments are working with us on breaking our leases
no
early.
No shit.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're selling everything we own. Leaving. We will be unemployed and homeless in 8 days.
Yeah.
God, if y'all make it to that other mountain, it's going to be like, why go back to Beaumont?
That's
like,
an option.
We can, we don't have anything bringing us back there. We can just go.
Well,
you
know, I'll have a storage unit here and a car.
But you could just like stop at any one of these places and just be like a camp counselor or something and just be like, hey, y'all need some help?
There's actually a lot of jobs. Like, I mean, once you get off the trail.
There's work you can pick up.
Yeah, like once you get off the trail, you can basically walk into any outfitter that sells equipment for mm-hmm. things like this.
Like, hey.
Like not an Academy or Walmart Sporting Goods, like
REI.
An REI or any other major outfitter for legitimate things. And you can walk right in and start working because you know what you're talking about.
And
this is a big deal.
Right,
watch us go to one and they're like, we've had 600 AT through hikers apply for a job.
Don't go to one up there. Go to one.
Go to the one
that, like, right here with the drop-off area.
You got to go to those old, like, general store/petrol stations with one old guy who's like, well, You know what?
Sometimes dad is better.
These kids got some crazy ideas, but I'm gonna let them push a broom.
It's it's really interesting. Like both of us have left our jobs. Yeah. Both of us have.
I mean, that could be considered a migrant workforce.
We don't have an apartment when we leave. I mean,
yeah,
we're kind of putting all of our eggs in this.
But what
basket.
About what about pets? Do you guys have pets?
I have two dogs.
No,
what are y'all gonna do with all them?
Cat is being fostered.
Her cat's being fostered. I have two dogs who are currently looking for a home.
Oh,
all right. Sad. Well, let's find them a home real quick.
Yeah, we gotta see if we can put this out in time.
Yeah, they're yeah. I have two dogs who are looking for a home. They've been spoiled rotten and they're
spoiled rotten.
But they're great dogs.
Yeah.
But that's we're working on.
That's how much upheaval there is, though. So you quit your job, you break your lease, you save money, you find people to take care of your pets, and then you go off on this thing, this venture. And then what do you also, like, what do you even do with your car? Like, how are you getting to Georgia? You're not just going to drive to Georgia and then abandon your car, right?
No, I paid my car off 2 weeks ago. I have no car note. My car's paid off. Dropped my insurance.
I have a family member who's taking
my car. We are actually renting a car to drive to Georgia. We're staying in a hotel. We've already, so there are people who shuttle folks from nearby cities to the approach trail or to the start of Springer Mountain. So we've already booked our shuttle. Who's picking us up? She already knows what time. She already has an address. And she will bring us to the start.
Are there any like glampers that do the trail?
Yes,
like,
are there any
like super rich people that just get the nicest stuff?
So there's
and they like have somebody else carry their shit for them or
so
something.
So the trail itself, is marked with white blaze marks.
Yeah.
So if you're white blazing, it means that you're a true hiker. You're doing it. You're a pure hiker. You're doing it the right way.
It's like skiing. Like there's the black trails and stuff. Yeah.
But then there's like any trail that breaks off of the Appalachian Trail is marked with blue blaze marks.
Okay.
Or any trail that intersects it that is not the Appalachian Trail is marked with blue blaze marks.
Little side trails.
So if you'd like to do the scenic routes, you're blue blazing.
Hmm.
Then there's a bunch of other cover terms. From green blazing means you're carrying.
Yeah, green
ground blazing means you're hiking to find some place to poop. If you're pink blazing,
it's true.
If you're pink blazing, you're dude blazing, or banana blazing.
Does that mean you're like finding love on the trail?
You're chasing somebody.
You're chasing tail.
Okay.
And then there's what they call red blazing. You're hiking with an injury. Yellow blazing means you're cheating and you're hiking along the yellow blaze marks on the side of the road.
You're hitchhiking.
You're cheating. And then there's what they call platinum blazers. Is exactly what you're talking about. Like platinum people blazers. Who go out there with like. Like they spent $12,000 on equipment. Like they have the best possible stuff you could possibly imagine.
They have like a 1.5-gram sat phone that's made of like carbon fiber.
I wish we could get statistics on how many like platinum blazers actually set out for a through and make it.
Yeah, there's a lot of, there's like 3 million people a year hike this trail. Through hike it. But just hike
on the trail.
Oh, they're just on the trail.
Yeah. I mean, this is in some people's backyard,
right?
Yeah,
and it's
section
also in like
hikers,
some
day
like
hikers.
state.
Like if you live along the trail, like it's a big part of your, you know.
Does it go through like Blue Ridge National Park?
It does
Park?
Go through Blue Ridge.
So I've been on the trail before, you know.
You
so,
might have
yeah.
honestly.
Yeah, I've been
like
on it, yeah,
3 million people a year are going to hike along this trail at some point. So, yeah, there's a lot of like. And that's gonna be a thing. There's a lot of like day hikers,
yeah,
weekend hikers, section hikers, flip floppers.
What's a flip flop?
No bow.
They
do
it a piece at a time.
There's a northbound through hiker, no bow.
That's what we'll be
Sobo,
doing.
Sobo, which is southbound.
Okay.
Where they start from Maine and go south.
Right.
And then there's flip floppers who
do it up and then down.
Well, they'll hit like, okay, this month I'm gonna hike from this point to this
point.
Then I'm gonna hop off the trail. And start at the top and go down for about a month and then come back down because they hit the best spots at the best time.
Oh, okay.
Through hike the trail, but they hike different
in
sections.
Yeah.
In pieces.
That doesn't sound through. I'm pretty sure that the
they
word
hike
through
the entirety
means
of the trail.
Going through.
They hike,
but they just do it in segregated sections.
Versus a section hiker, which is basically the same thing.
But they just do it a piece at a time.
They do it a piece at a time. So like they'll hike a section. Like maybe they can get 2 weeks off a year for your work.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
They'll get do off, it like 5 years or 6 years for, or something.
Yeah. The longest one, it took 45 years.
Wow.
To complete it, section hiking. Like it took them 45 years to have enough time off to hike the whole thing. But a flip-flopper is a section hiker who does it all in one run.
Goes all over the place.
He's just, you know, hiking each section as he wants to hike it.
Yeah.
They want to hike it and then they finish it up.
There's a lot of culture on the trail, I'm finding. There's a lot of like terms to
like trail angels or something like that.
Trail angels and trail magic.
I'm really excited.
What's trail magic?
So trail magic is what trail angels do. It's just left behind without a face to thank. So like you might come across a cooler in the middle of the woods, just chest full of fresh apples and beer and soda.
Yeah.
And it'll have a sign that says trail magic. Like it's just some. Because like I said, like so many people from the area along the trail, it's part of their economy. It's part of their culture. And a lot of them have hiked the trail or through hiked it or section hiked it. And they might just like, you know, we stopped at the grocery store. Let's buy this bag of apples and hang it from a tree.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, for hikers going through. Because we know I went through there.
I know
I
went there and needed a damn apple.
And like that's called trail magic. It's just, and there's it's a big deal. And trail just angels are the people who do trail
good
magic.
Good Samaritans that try to help hikers along the way.
Okay, there's good Samaritans, but I've also heard that like there's people sometimes along the trail that can be assholes. Yeah. Like, have you guys heard about that?
I mean, that's in life in general.
Yeah. I mean, I know. I just
it's the
I heard
way
like
that
sometimes locals like to just be jerks.
I mean,
that's probably pretty standard of life.
It's just a smaller microcosm of life. I mean, there's going to be people you don't like. There's going to be people that you befriend very
quickly. Gotta hate it whenever people walk in the woods.
Yeah. I feel like there's no difference.
These goddamn out of towners need to get out of my cafe.
Well,
tell you right now.
Not if we've been saving thousands of dollars to come here and eat a whole bunch. That hiker hunger's real.
$6,000 you're going to spread out along this trail.
Yeah, that hiker hunger's real. We're going to be real hungry.
I believe it.
Along that trail.
No, there's definitely like, it isn't entirely safe. In 1993, two women were murdered.
Some murders or something.
Murdered,
yeah.
Two women were hiking it together. They hopped off the trail. Someone followed them back. Never seen alive again.
Oh, so they weren't murdered on trail. Someone found them out.
They were murdered on trail.
But they went. They
but somebody found them from outside the trail.
Pay very little attention to this. These are two people.
You have to leave the trail, right?
These are two people in 1993. This has been over 20 years ago.
Yeah,
again, small microcosms of the real world around us.
The statistics of that are far greater than being struck by lightning. Because if you're saying that 3 million people are on this trail every year, and the last known murder was in 1993,
it was the last known.
There was a woman in. It was like 5-6 years ago who went missing and never seen again.
Yeah, whatever.
It happened.
Because the statistics for being struck by lightning, I think, is like 1 in 720,000.
Oh, yeah. So even then, it's still pretty rare.
It's pretty rare.
So
there's, I mean, like, we will be hiking through the town the Deliverance is based on.
That's like at the very beginning of the trail, isn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty early. It's in Virginia. But that's the thing.
That means you're in danger.
I am not at all concerned about this town.
At all. You hear banjos, man. Just hide.
Just run.
Yeah,
just like
well, like I told Daniel, they probably have no interest in me. Just drop your pack and run. I'll grab you things.
Just run, Daniel.
But no, honestly, like, all the threats that are out there, the biggest one is, like, it's
yourself,
not bears. It's not other people.
Yeah.
It's Lyme disease in the environment.
That's true.
Also your mental fortitude.
Mental fortitude. Yeah. I don't know. We're both pretty stubborn.
Staying positive.
Like,
upbeat.
You know, we asked Heather earlier about like people who told her she wasn't going to be able to make it.
Mm. Yeah.
And I actually haven't got much of it. No one telling me I wasn't going to make it. Like that pretty much hasn't happened.
I really think the big thing is that you're ex-military. Yeah. You've been to Afghanistan. I don't think anybody's worried about you making it.
People know me,
but
I've told people Heather's coming with me. I've had people say like, oh,
are
you worried
about
Heather coming with you? Like,
trail.
Is she going to be able to make it?
So,
and I've gotten
so
it
this
for
is
her.
Also kind of like a, this episode will serve as like a little bit of a, like, all right, guys.
God help us.
You know, like, so I have told.
And either way, we want a part two, so.
I have told everyone about, like, when it came down to me and Heather going, I was like, and for, you know, everyone knows Heather, like, She's a stubborn asshole.
She thinks, babe.
She's
making it. That was said in endearment. I know.
So the thing is like,
he's smiling. So.
We're going to have our bad days where we can't move forward.
We have our bad days. And we're about to quit.
But the thing is if I'm also a stubborn asshole. Yeah. So I know if I get up and I'm able to take one step forward, Heather's going to take two just because.
Yeah. Right.
And I will take two because Heather took two. I'll take three. Neither one of us will be the one to quit.
Right.
So I think Heather is capable of making it on her own without me. And I think I'm capable of making it on my own without her. But I think the fact that we're both going together and stubborn as we are, we're definitely going to finish because neither one of us will quit in front of the other.
So when you get to the end in Maine, like the first thing you're going to be is like, just fuck you. That's like, that's the big thing.
Fuck everybody. Yeah.
We
made it, but also like, fuck off.
Well, no, I keep saying that like my plan is like, man, if we finally hit Katahdin, if we make it to Katahdin, I'm stopping at the nearest gas station. We are buying the cheapest bottle of champagne possible.
Hell yeah.
We are
You should get whatever you're nearing.
Right. We are hiking up that bottle of champagne. We're popping a bottle. We're staying on the mountain.
It's going to be warm as hell.
I already know. Yeah, right. Well, probably going to be so cold.
It's not even going to fizzle anymore.
By that point, I'm probably going to cry.
By that point, you guys are looking to finish around October, I guess, yeah?
Around September,
okay.
Yeah. It'll be nice and cold up in the mountaintops. Yeah. We can chill the champagne and some snow on the ground.
I'm telling you. And then I want to get off. I want to get a hotel room. I want to take the longest shower of my life.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to take the longest shower of my life. I want to get normal people clothes, and I want to eat enough Maine lobster to kill a small toddler.
they'll get mercury poisoning.
Should toddlers eat lobster? It's not very much lobster to kill a toddler.
I don't know. but yeah, I mean, God, there's just so much to unwrap with this trip.
It sounds like you got a plan in place. It sounds like you're doing it. You're ready. You're leaving in what, six days?
Eight days.
Well, we'll be on the trail in 8 days.
You'll
We're
be on the trail
in six.
So you'll be leaving in six
from today.
I'm getting like you know, you get excited about something. I'm getting excited for y'all.
I have no idea what's going on in here.
I'm excited and I'm kind of jealous because like I said, I got a backpack. I'm planning on starting to go hiking this year.
Call to nature is a strong thing.
Well, you know, but, Zach, if you want to come fly or drive out and come section hike with us for a little while.
Even a weekend, man.
Just a weekend.
That's
we're
on the table.
We're going to keep everyone posted. We have our Facebook group.
Put me in that group.
If anyone wants to like meet us at some point, we'll tell you where we'll be. You can hop right on.
I get a lot of random time off, so that wouldn't be.
So what's the name of that group one more time? As we're nearing the end, so
it's Daniel and Heather's Appalachian Trail Through Hike.
Okay, that's
so if you're friends with either one of us on Facebook,
you can find
just let us know. We're sending invites. We're posting it on both of our pages intermittently, just so folks can join it. It's an open group. We're accepting everybody. If anybody wants to follow,
invite
them,
who you want to invite. If you're already a member,
yeah.
I'd say words of encouragement are welcome.
Absolutely.
Well, I'm so stoked. Like I'm excited for y'all, and I plan on keeping up, and we'll share some updates from y'all too.
Absolutely, we're more than happy.
I don't know when we're gonna get this out. Probably while y'all.
Probably gonna be while y'all on the trail.
We will definitely be already gone. Yeah.
Do you think you'll be able to download it and listen?
Yes.
I'm keeping my Spotify account.
We were so positive then, and now everything's.
We plan on being back in town 3 days into the trail. Not this town, but like we'll be back into a town.
Yeah.
On our third day. I've already planned out our first 3 days of hiking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And mileage and everything. On the third day, we'll be 5 mile hike and then into town.
Okay,
cool.
So on 3 days into the trail, we'll be back in civilization.
Okay. And then you'll go back.
We'll keep
you'll
in
get
touch.
On the trail
yeah.
Back. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll be in touch.
Well, you know what, guys? I think y'all are going to do it. I wish you all the best of luck because you are both stubborn assholes. I know you're going to do it. So I don't even need to say good luck. But I know Zach, you know, he shares my sentiments too. Mm-hmm. So. But thank you guys for coming on. Thanks for telling your story so far.
Yeah.
And I really hope there's a part two. So whenever you guys finish, we'll have you back on. And then we can ask you guys how it went. And, you know, get
the other
version.
Yeah.
The other version of this bright-eyed, bushy-tailed sort of thing. And
stark contrast, I think, I'm sure.
If we bring you back, we're gonna have to bring a bottle of champagne and do it live so we can let you say fuck you to everybody.
You can
just come on up to Mount Katahdin, Maine, and we'll do it live from
Meet us there.
All right. Well, that's been AZ, and thanks for listening.
Take a walk on the wild side. I said, hey, Joe, take a walk on the wild side.
All right, thanks, Heather and Daniel. Definitely go check out their Facebook page if you want to keep up with them where they're at.
Yeah, and also a special shout-out to all of our patrons. We have Jordan Stringer, Lance Killian, Brian Castino, Doug Waldrop, Michael Saar, Ben McClellan, and Randy Edwards. You guys are great. Y'all help us do what we do. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you find some sort of satisfaction out of doing it.
Yeah.
And if you would like to join the ranks of our super homies in...
Super homie ranks.
Super homie ranks, Doc. You can head on over to patreon.com/A to Z BMT, where you can donate $1, $5. You can have a reoccurring one. It doesn't matter. A one-time donation.
Yeah.
Whatever you feel like. If you find value out of this and you want to donate, that's how you do it.
All right, and then our next episode that's coming out soon, we will talk to Michael Saar. He's a local librarian.
And research expert.
Research expert. Also, he's actored. He's been in Ad Hoc and all those other kind of groups. So he's pretty a cool roundabout dude. But we talk about what makes a librarian in the modern day and age.
For sure. And also, if you have a guest that you think would be a good fit on our show, maybe somebody that you want to get the scoop on, I mean, send them our way. We're looking for all kinds of people. Just anybody interesting, anybody with a story to tell, maybe anybody with a profession or an expert or anything.
Yep, and that's the show. See you next time. We'll be right back.